Some people have asked me if I chose to continue my travels to Ankara and Istanbul to send a message to the world. And my answer is simple. Evet. Yes.
Evet. President Obama spoke to the Turkish parliament today in Turkish. On Sunday in Prague, the president spoke to some Czechs in Czech.
Sametova revoluce. The Velvet Revolution taught us many things.
Okay, now he's just showing off. His Berlitz Guide tour of Europe, of course, follows his Spanish message to the audience at the Latin Music Awards and his Happy New Year wish to the Iranian people, which was partly in Farsi. So President Obama is kind of polylingually impressive, but why point it out tonight? Well, for comparison's sake, honestly. Well, the person who won the 2008 presidential election is, I guess, wowing the world in its native languages. The person once expected to be the strongest challenger to him in 2012 is fighting really awkward, sad private family battles in public. The 2008 Republican vice presidential candidate and still Alaska governor, Sarah Palin, has joined a rhetorical battle with the father of her grandchild. Now, in truth, it was Levi Johnston who started it. He chose the daytime talk show Tyra to say what he wanted to say and to talk specifically about whether or not Sarah Palin knew what was going on between him and Sarah Palin's daughter, Bristol.
Did she think you were abstinent?
No.
Okay, so she knew that you guys were active. You think she knew?
I'm pretty sure she probably knew.
Uh-oh. That piece of daytime TV history led a spokesperson for Governor Palin to issue a formal anti-Levi Johnston statement to be printed on the pages of People magazine. Quote, Bristol did not even know Levi was going on the show. We're disappointed that Levi and his family, in a quest for fame, attention, and fortune, are engaging in flat-out lies, gross exaggeration, and even distortion of their relationship. Bristol's focus will remain on raising Tripp, completing her education, and advocating abstinence. It's unfortunate that Levi finds it more appealing to exploit his previous relationship with Bristol than to contribute to the well-being of their child. It's a fair point, but it doesn't seem like the sort of thing leading politicians speak about in glossy magazines. There was a time when Sarah Palin was throwing Levi Johnston into the middle of the presidential campaign, you will recall. Him on a tarmac to shake hands with candidate John McCain. Him in the fancy seats and on TV screens across the country during the Republican convention. But since the election, the picture of Sarah Palin's family, constructed for the TV cameras, formed in essence to be part of her political platform, has become far more complicated and sad. Sad that it is being played out now in public. Her daughter Bristol and Levi Johnston broke up. Their impending marriage, which was announced during the campaign, was called off. Levi's mother was arrested on drug charges, reportedly linked to OxyContin. Last week, Todd Palin's half-sister was arrested on burglary charges. And that's just the personal stuff. Governor Palin stumbled through the stimulus fight, rejecting federal money for Alaska before backtracking and taking it. Last week, she got precisely zero support for her call for Alaska's Democratic Senator Mark Begich to resign because Ted Stevens's corruption conviction was overturned. And in his most recent public appearances, her former patron, Senator John McCain, essentially said that if Sarah Palin runs for president in 2012, she should not automatically count on his vote. Joining us now is Connie Schultz, Pulitzer Prize-winning columnist for the Cleveland Plain Dealer. Connie, it's great to have you back on the show. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Rachel. Hello from Cleveland.
Hi. Is this... Do you think this is sort of the ugly side of the decision to run your family as if they are part of your political platform?
You know, I have to say I respond to this first and foremost as a mother. And parents make mistakes, and you would like parents not to keep making the same mistakes. And she, I think, erred when Governor Palin first felt the need to trot her daughter out in public and talk about her pregnancy, made her part of the campaign. I never saw a happy moment with that child and her boyfriend. I feel really bad for these kids. And now the governor is, let's keep in mind, she is bashing the family of her grandson. These are relatives of her grandson, including his father, and this is so inappropriate. There's a part of me that thinks, phew, Thank God she's not vice president. But on the other hand, I wonder how much of the country is going to be paying attention to all this. I'll tell you, here in Cleveland, I hear a lot from not just liberal readers, I hear a lot from conservatives. And this is one thing that's not playing very well, particularly with mothers here. They're really tired of it, and she needs to stop.
It has seemed to me like kids get a lot of leeway to screw up, especially when their parents are in the public eye, that kids who do things wrong or do things that are uncouth in some way, I feel like we sort of as a country ought to make a decision, just a values-based decision, to cut them some slack. The thing that is hard for me to imagine is being an official on the payroll spokesman for Sarah Palin and choosing to wade in there and go and start a fight and engage in this fight with Mr. Johnston and his family. I mean, he is, what, 18 years old. Whatever it meant for his decision to go on this TV talk show, to have then decided to wade in there and be there with him and fight it out in People magazine, to me, is just, it's political malpractice, and it's a remarkable decision.
It's inappropriate to have a staff person on government payroll to be giving any sort of explanation for this. Look, we're all, you know, as we've established before on the show, my husband is in the Senate. We have four children. We would never, ever feel that we have any obligation to explain to the public some of the difficulties that our own children have had or will have in the future. And isn't it interesting that perhaps the wisest, if not the most articulate voice in this has been Bristol Palin when she went on television last month, I believe, or perhaps it was even February, and said absence as an education model does not work. And she said she wished she had waited 10 years to have this child. Her mother barged in that interview, as you'll recall, and immediately said, well, what Bristol is trying to say is that it's hard, but you can get through it. No, that's not what Bristol Palin was saying. She was really trying to appeal to her fellow teenagers, please wait. And if you don't wait, please use protection, because you don't want to be in this situation. I feel really bad for her. And I know the publicity has been incredibly difficult for her. And I think of what my former colleague, Karen Sandstrom, when she interviewed the African-American poet Lucille Clifton, she shared two lines with me that I've never forgotten from that interview. What they call you is one thing. What you answer to is something else. Mm. And I think at a very young age, Bristol Palin needs to figure out who she is and and how to decide for herself what she will answer to. And unfortunately, that may require ignoring some of the baloney that her mother's throwing out there right now.
Connie, do you think that the way this is playing out and the fact that it is playing out publicly is going to have a material effect on Sarah Palin's political fortunes?
I certainly hope so, because, you know, you and I think, talked about it when she was first nominated. There are good candidates that are women and bad candidates that are women, the same with men. And she is a poor candidate in so many ways. I would not want her representing my city, my state, certainly my country. And I say that in part because I don't like what she's been willing to do with her children. But also, you look at the stimulus package, I'm taking only half. No, wait a minute. I'll take two-thirds. No, wait a minute. I guess we'll take it all, but I'm not going to say the amount. That is not decisive leadership. And frankly, that should be the focus, but we keep getting distracted by these theatrics that she's producing about her own family. And I feel bad for these two kids, and they are kids. I don't know if you saw the interview with Levi, but he's a kid. That's a long list. Young men who want to get a little bit of attention so they go on TV. I don't hold him responsible for this.
I was struck by the fact that he refers to himself as a kid when he's talking about himself, which I thought showed some, yeah. Connie Schultz, columnist for the Cleveland Plain Dealer, Pulitzer Prize winner, and as it is relevant materially to the discussion of this issue, the wife of Ohio Senator Sherrod Brown. Connie, thank you so much. Right. Have a good night.